You're listening to the audio production of It Is What You Make of It, Creating Something Great from What You've Been Given by Justin McRoberts, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
Introduction. The sculpture we call David didn't exist until Michelangelo took hammer and chisel and did the hard work of making it. Up to that point, there was only marble. Relatedly, Michelangelo had a hammer to use because about 3.3 million years before he was born, some blessed sister or brother used a large rock to crush smaller rock into splinters and eventually strapped a stick of some sort to a similar rock and discovered they could crush rock with even greater force. Just about nothing is what it is. Not in a world inhabited by people created in the image of God, in whose hands are both creation and resurrection. The capacity to make and remake is a thumbprint of the divine on humanity. I'll go so far as to say that we dishonor our Creator when we give in to it is what it is thinking. Love doesn't just win. Mercy doesn't just triumph. Light doesn't just cast out shadow. Peace doesn't just get a chance. Forgiveness doesn't just restore. And time has never healed a single wound without the loving, attentive way people have spent that time after hurting one another. All of these essential aspects of human life require the work of human hands. Hands committed to a vision of the world made right, or at least a world made better. Hands of someone created in the image of God, which includes the ability to be creative. You were born with the capacity to create. Maybe you weren't told that at home while growing up, or in school, or in the training you did for your job. But if your teachers or trainers or neighbors drew a line between who you are and what you do, whatever it is, they were wrong. Maybe you were told that you just teach, or just parent, or just coach, or just lead your team at the office, or just play your part on the team. I'd like to help you see how limited that view of who you are actually is, to see what you're capable of, and maybe even what you've already been up to this whole time. The question in traditional art making is all about what to do with what we have on hand. It is a question almost always focused on what's next. For an artist, feeling stuck is just another call to creativity. Writer's block, for example, is a way an artist's soul says, this isn't the way I'm supposed to feel. The stuck writer doesn't say, well, looks like that's it. I'm not a writer anymore now that I feel stuck. She says, I've got this problem right now. I'll call it writer's block. I need to find a way to fix it or get it out so that I can get back to being who I am and doing what I'm designed to do. I'm a writer after all. There are no dead ends for artists. Dead ends are simply more radical and challenging invitations to create a way forward. And I get it. There's a virtual army of contentious voices around you screaming that life is what it is, and particularly in places you feel stuck. Your work life, it is what it is. Your social life, it is what it is. Your physical health, it is what it is. I'm saying that's all garbage. Your life is not just a set of stale circumstances that are what they are, without any hope of change or improvement or transformation. I don't know exactly where that voice is coming from in your particular life, but I want to help you locate it and shut it up forever. I'd like to help you silence it and replace it with something more like this. I am a beloved child of God, the same God who created all things out of nothing. I'm created in the image of that loving, creating, death-defying, circumstance-transforming God. I am a creature who creates. And anything and everything I do with my time on this earth and in this body is a reflection and an expression of who I am. So I'm going to tell you a few stories in expectation that after reading them, you will look at your own life and circumstances and resources and opportunities and obstacles. Step over that whole it is what it is nonsense. Turn your eyes upward to the God who made you to be a maker and say, let's see what we can make of this. Throughout this book, I'll walk through key moments from my 20 plus years as an artist, church planter, pastor, songwriter, author, neighbor, husband, father, passing on lessons and practices I've learned about making something good from what I've been given rather than simply accepting it as it is. I'll invite you to see yourself as an agent of love and redemption in your household, your neighborhood, your workplace, and wherever you find yourself. I will challenge us to wisely re-examine the apparently immovable systems you and I participate in, political, religious, economic, and to see our essential role in long-term change. I will invite you to believe that you are a partner with God in the renewing of all things. Christ in you, wrote the Apostle Paul, the hope of glory. Christ, who took things like bread and dirt and water and made miracles, in you, the hope of glory. Christ, who took a small group of souls and built the global movement we call the church, in you, the hope of glory. Christ, who took death itself into his outstretched hands and made from it life eternal, in you, the hope of glory. Each of these stories is propelled by a constant prayer that sounds something like this. Let there not be one square inch in all of human existence about which you and I say it is what it is. Instead, may it be so that every moment of our collective time here together is marked by the power and potential of the knowledge that it is what we make of it. Chapter 1. Mr. Ross sets the tone. I went to Clayton Valley High School in Concord, California. I wasn't a great student until my senior year. Some of that was because I didn't like math. The larger part of it was that I didn't know what to make of high school. I had no intention of doing any of the jobs high school, as I understood it, was going to prepare me for. So I felt stuck and unmotivated. Until I got in trouble in Mr. Ross's speech class. After that, everything started to come into focus. Mr. Ross turned from the chalkboard and barked, "Mr. McRoberts!" I stopped mid-joke, busted again for mouthing off in class. And this was speech class, no less. I mean, who gets in trouble for talking in a class about talking? Turns out, McRoberts does. I started packing up for a trip to the principal's office. That's how things normally went for me. One joke too many, and then poof, detention. But as I stood up to leave, Mr. Ross stopped me and beckoned me towards the front of the class. "You can set your bag down right here." He walked from his desk to a closet door I'd seen him open maybe twice the entire semester. After rummaging around in the closet for a while, he pulled from it a large inflatable cactus and turned back to me. Now, it's probably worth asking why Mr. Ross had an inflatable cactus in his supply closet. To the best of my recollection, that cactus had never made an appearance prior to that moment, and I don't think we ever saw it again. Which is to say, I haven't the foggiest idea why Mr. Ross had an inflatable cactus at the ready, but boy am I glad he did. My life was never the same afterward. He led me to the center of the stage area at the front of the class and set the cactus next to me. Then, Mr. Ross took a seat at my desk and said, "Go ahead." I glanced back and forth between the cactus, which was almost my height, and Mr. Ross. The room buzzed with whispers and giggles. I was starting to feel off balance and dizzy. What do you want me to do? Mr. Ross leaned back in my chair and said, "The floor is yours, Mr. McRoberts. Make us laugh. I will give you extra credit for using the cactus." I don't recall how much time passed while I stood there with that silly plastic prop feeling ridiculous and doing absolutely nothing. What I do remember, and I will never forget, is that someone eventually broke the heavy silence saying, "Sheesh, Jay, just pretend like you're in the desert or something. It's just a cactus." Mr. Ross immediately responded, "No, it's not just a cactus." Then he turned to me, looked over the top of his glasses, and said, "It is what you make of it." I'm guessing that in one way or another, at least once in your life, you've been handed an inflatable cactus of sorts and had no idea what the right or best next move was. Or you've looked around to find that after all this time, nothing was what you thought it was, and you weren't sure where to go from there. Maybe it had to do with the job you can't win at, but also can't quit. Maybe it had to do with the relationship that's been at the same dead end for months or even years, but you feel trapped and incapable of fixing it. Maybe it has to do with the passion project you no longer have the passion for, but can't shake out of your head. Whatever it is or was, I'm guessing you know what I'm talking about. I'm also guessing that along the way, you might have said something along the lines of, well, it is what it is. And I get it. That's a really convenient and comfortable thing to say. It is what it is. But lean in for a moment and I'll tell you a secret. I hate those words. Actually, I hate them a lot. I think those words are almost always a trap. I think those words are far too often a way to settle for less than what your soul wants, less than what your talents make you capable of, and way less than what God wants for you. I'd like to suggest that the power of potentiality is God's thumbprint on the ones made in God's image, and that it is the primary way to express the divine spark at the center of human life. I might even go so far as to say that when I give in to it is what it is thinking, I dishonor the creative, redemptive, and loving God who made me and holds me together. I generally use the phrase it is what it is when I've come up against an undesirable circumstance or a seemingly insurmountable problem. The issue I have isn't simply that saying it is what it is basically amounts to quitting, but also that the phrase is almost entirely untrue. Just about nothing in the realm of human existence simply is what it is. Most every set of circumstances we find ourselves in is the cumulative result of decisions other people have made. Admittedly, there's a very wide range of experience here. The dishes stacked up in and around the kitchen sink might be the direct result of a series of choices a spouse or a roommate has made to eat without any plan to clean up afterward. That's pretty simple. Annoying is all get out, but simple. On the other hand, there are realities that are considerably more complex, like how nearly one in three human beings lacks access to clean drinking water, or that Black Americans are nearly six times more likely to be arrested and imprisoned than their white American neighbors. Both of those realities have layers of complex causal histories. Regardless, none of those circumstances or realities was handed down from on high to simply be received and left unexamined, unquestioned, or unchanged. All of them can be changed. All of them should be changed. Hold on for a moment while I go clean up the kitchen sink. Now, I get that a difficult conversation with a messy spouse or a roommate sounds far less daunting than the deep personal examination of work required to undo systemic racism and poverty. But at the heart of both movements is the question, what will I do with what I have on hand? If I respond to undesirable incidents or behavioral patterns, or even to evil itself with, it is what it is, I relinquish my right and God-ordained responsibility to push back against darkness by adding my own light. Human history is not a sequence of cold, immovable circumstances, begetting other cold, immovable circumstances with you and me either happily or unhappily in tow. Instead, human history is shaped by the ideas, the dreams, and ultimately by the will and work of the women and men who actively create, tear down, reimagine, and rebuild. The undoing of evil and the making of good is and always will be a matter of will and work. Until 1833, slavery was legal in the British Empire. Instead of saying it is what it is, William Wilberforce, British abolitionist, said, "Let's make something else." For the first 144 years of American history, women were not allowed to vote, even though they'd given birth to the entire voting populace. Settling for it is what it is just wasn't in the cards for Susan B. Anthony, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, or Alice Paul, even as I write this. Nearly a quarter of the world's populace lives in extreme poverty. Many of those people are children who, because of their poverty, are far more susceptible to the exploitative practices of slave traders and pimps. I cannot, with good conscience, look at a world shaped that way and say, it is what it is. Not even with something as seemingly monolithic as global poverty. Why? Because global poverty, far from being an inevitable and unchangeable circumstance into which people are born, is the ongoing result of a progressive series of choices made by those with power and influence. I'm learning to intentionally look at what I've been given including the more problematic parts of who I am. And instead of just saying, I'm just this way, or I'm just the way I am, I'm asking myself, what can I make of this? The moments, stories, insights, and practices I've discovered along the way with my answers to that question are joyfully reshaping my life. And I hope your own answers reshape you as you approach your life from a creative and redemptive frame of mind.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.